bring forward during the service. And so we don't actually take up an offering. We ask you, if you are giving an offering in the cash form, to most people give via standing orders. But if you do it in this way, then there's a plate at the door as you come in. And many people this morning have realized that. So thank you. And Lord, we just thank you for your blessings. We thank you that you give, and in return we give to you, Lord. We give back to you our tithes, our offering, that this might be used, Lord, in your service in this place and throughout the world. In the name of Jesus, amen. We're going now into a time of prayer. And Father, we're in your presence. We want to thank you. Thank you again for all that you've done for us. Thank you that you're the one who is with us 24/7, every day of the year. Thank you, Father, that your word says that you never leave us or forsake us, whatever our circumstances. Whether we're going through a really traumatic time at the moment or whether we're on top of the mountain, you're with us, and we thank you. There are those amongst us, Lord, who are really sad at the moment because they've lost loved ones, and the world seems to have crumbled around them, and they need your strong arms, Lord. Will you hold them secure? Will you comfort them in their distress? Will you fulfill your promises in their lives? For those who are sick amongst us, Lord, we pray for your healing. You are the God who heals. And we pray, Lord, that by your Spirit, you would do wonderful and mighty things in this place. For those who need your touch now, Lord, who are gathered here amongst us, we pray, come, Holy Spirit. Touch lives, renew, restore. Lift up where things seem to have been cast down. We're going through a time of change, Lord, in our country. In the same week, we had a new Prime Minister and a new King. And we pray for the government. Your word tells us, Lord, that we should pray for those in authority over us, and we just lift King Charles, and we lift Liz Truss and the government to you, Lord. And we ask that we might be a land that is governed with righteousness and justice. Look out from our own land, and we see wars and rumours of wars, trouble and strife. And you've warned us in your word, Lord, that we would expect to see these things because the world is not as it should be. But Father, we long to see peace. We long to see your kingdom come, and that's a kingdom which is in people's hearts rather than an earthly kingdom, Lord. We pray that you would change lives. We pray that where people have taken up arms against one another, you would bring peace. Where we pray that in places where tyrannical powers seem to be at large, that they would be overthrown, and goodness and righteousness would come. We pray for our church outreach and witness, Lord, that we might be a people who declare the praises of God in this generation. Pray for all the things that will happen in this building during the week, that by your Spirit you would be at work, that lives would be changed, eyes would be opened to the goodness of our God. And we pray for our young people, Lord. We've already prayed for some of them as they've gone to their groups, but we pray for the older young people as well that are connected to this church, the teenagers. Keep them strong in faith, Lord. Protect them. Hold them, Lord, in your strong hand. And so we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your goodness. We're amazed at your love for us, Lord, because we know that there is none righteous, no, not even one in this room, that we've all fallen short of your glory. Yet in Jesus you've arrayed us in robes of righteousness. And as we come, Lord, to share communion together this morning, we pray that you would remind us afresh of all that it cost to bring our redemption, new life, everlasting life, that our relationship with you might be restored for all eternity. Thank you, Father. The music group can come up again, and we're going to sing one song before we come into communion. It's a song, "I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene."
If you'd like to stand, please do. If you want to remain sitting, then that's fine as well.
In Psalm 23, it says, "You prepare before me a table in the presence of my enemies." And I just think that that's probably a prophetic thing that points us in a way to what we're going to do now, because this is a special meal. This is a banqueting house meal. It reminds me too of that verse in the Song of Solomon, I think it's chapter 2 and verse 4, where it says, "Brought me into his banqueting hall, and his banner over me is love." This is the love feast of the Christian church. This is the reminder of what it cost for us to be God's redeemed people. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, who on the night he was betrayed took the bread as the disciples sat around the table, and he broke it and he said, "This is for you. Do this in remembrance of me, that you won't forget what it cost." So we share the bread together. We eat it as it comes round, and individually we give thanks to our Father God for his Son Jesus, who died on a cross that we might have life. Those who are serving like to come forward. Thank you. Jesus shed his blood. So that he took upon himself the penalty for all our wrongdoing. The sin and shame which would rightfully be ours has been placed upon him and cleansed because of the shed blood. And that verse says we do it in the presence of our enemies, but they're not here seated with us, the enemies. They can only look from afar, because the shed blood is the blood that overcomes, that causes the powers of darkness to cringe and retreat. Jesus, the Saviour of the world, we thank you for your body given and your blood shed, that we might be forgiven and have life in all its fullness for all eternity. We love you, Lord. We give you our thanks, inadequate though it seems. And we now share in this cup together, just as Jesus shared with his disciples, as we remember and give thanks. The wine will be served and we retain it, and then we'll drink it all together in acknowledgement of our unity in Christ. The blood of Jesus shed for each one of us that brings us into his family. Thank you, Father. Beth's going to, with the musicians, lead us in a couple more worship songs. And then Peter's going to come and bring God's word to us.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Nice to be back here again. Well, we're going to read from 1 Peter, and then 2 Peter's going to speak. No. So this is a passage packed with biblical truth. We'll try and do justice to it this morning. So this is 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4, reading through to verse 10. As you come to him, talking about Jesus here, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him. You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." Now to you who believe, this stone is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that causes people to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Thank you then. Can we have the PowerPoint? That's fine there. Thank you. Now, I don't know whether this is true of you, but as I was growing up, I thought to myself, do I actually belong to this family? I don't know whether you understand that, but that thought went through mind. Do I actually belong to this family? And then I thought, well, I look like my brother David, and my brother looks like my mom, so I think I must belong to this family. And it's good to know where you belong. Today we're thinking about confidence in identity. And this passage is so rich. It's so rich. And if you're in any way uncertain of your identity, of who you are, and especially of who you are or might be in Jesus, this passage is for you. Actually, identity is a key issue in today's society. We hear about what we call identity politics. And we're hearing about people choosing what gender they would like to be. It's a huge issue in society. And my own conviction is that the more that we understand what it means for us to be in Jesus Christ, the more we will know who we are. Now, often we hear it said, particularly by celebrities, you know, you can be exactly what you want to be. It's not true. I'm never going to be a pop idol now. I'm never going to be a lots of things. Actually, what I am is what God created me to be. And that's different for all of us. But when we know that and we are secure in that, it's absolutely marvelous. Now, Jesus is described as the living stone, and we are described as living stones. So let me begin with the stones then. There are three views of Jesus that are expressed in these early verses. There is Jesus' view of himself, and he draws on pictures from the Old Testament, Isaiah 28:16 and Psalm 118, verse 22, which both appear in this passage. Peter is drawing on Old Testament scriptures about Jesus being the capstone or the cornerstone. Now, let me remind you of a parable that you probably know quite well. It's the parable of the tenants. And it's the one where the man went away for a while and the tenants looked after the vineyard. And then he wanted to get his share of the crop. And so he sent one of his servants and they treated him very badly. And he sent somebody else and they treated him badly. And then he sent somebody else and they killed him. And eventually, after sending quite a few, he said, "Look, I'll send my son, because surely they'll respect my son." But when the son came, they said, "Oh, this is the heir." And so they killed him. And at the end of the parable, it says the leaders, the Jewish leaders, knew that Jesus was telling this parable against them because they were rejecting of the living stone that God had provided for them. So Jesus knew who he was. That's his view of himself. He was drawing on Old Testament scripture. But then what about God's view of Jesus? It says, as far as God is concerned, Jesus is the chosen stone. He is the precious stone, chosen from before the foundation of the world. And that verse that I love, when Jesus is at the baptism and the voice came from heaven and he says, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." That's God's view of Jesus. But then what about the people's view of Jesus? Well, Jesus was both rejected and accepted by people. Those verses at the beginning of John's gospel where it says he came to his own, but his own did not receive him. He was in the world, but the world did not recognize him. But as many as received him, and they took him into the heart, and they were known as children of God. Okay, three views of Jesus expressed there about the preciousness of Jesus. But what about you? How do you view him? Who is he to you? As I was putting this together and praying over it yesterday, I was just thinking about the time that I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I think I'd believed in Jesus a little earlier than that and come to him. But I was filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 18. And I remember thinking and telling people, I didn't realize Jesus could be so wonderful. That was the sort of sentiment that was in my heart. As the Holy Spirit had just come to me and filled me. And in the process, you don't just get filled with the Spirit, you just get more absorbed and in love with the person of Jesus. And I didn't realize Jesus could be so wonderful. What's your impression of Jesus here? Who is he to you? How precious is he to you? God wants to do that for us. So according to verses 6 to 8, people either build their lives on Jesus because he's precious, or they are destroyed by him. Here's the passage of Scripture. "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that causes people to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall." There are two things about Jesus here. First of all, he is the rejected stone. That's how he's described. He's the rejected stone in the way that the Jewish leaders had rejected him. He told his disciples several times, they will reject me. And those who rejected him treated him like a worthless stone that needed to be thrown into the skip. But actually, he was the capstone or the cornerstone. He was the most important stone. And they retrieved the stone from the skip, and then they built the foundation of the most important building on it. So although he was the rejected stone, he is the centerpiece as far as God is concerned. But as well as being the rejected stone, he's also the destructive stone. He's a stone which causes people to stumble. Now, stones can be used for both destructive and constructive purposes. With stones, we can throw and harm people or break windows. Or with stones, we can put together and see wonderful buildings erected. But this particular stone, people can trip over it. They can stumble over it. Now, why is this the case? It's because they do not believe in the Lord Jesus, and they reject him, and by disobeying the message, they find themselves in a bad and a sad place. Now, I don't know whether you noticed, but when you got to verse 8 that we've just looked at, and talks about those who have rejected Jesus, it uses the phrase, because this was what they were destined for. This was what they were appointed to. And it feels like and sounds like that this is God's will, that certain people have a destiny to reject Jesus. Doesn't mean that. See, the key ideas here are believing in Jesus and obeying Jesus. And for those people who do not believe in him and embrace who he is, and then follow through on that and obeying him, they will stumble. This lovely living stone will be something that crushes them or they stumble over. He's the rejected stone, but he's also the destructive stone for some people. And sadly, there are many people in our age who have decided to reject him. We were on the streets yesterday. As a church, we go out every fortnight and we have our gazebo up. And, you know, there's lots of wording on it. Listen, pray, and what's the hope? Three words on the gazebo. And we stand there and we're ready to just talk to anybody that wants to talk to us and pray with them. And before this, we were praying, and one of the group was lamenting the fact that so many people are just disinterested in Jesus. And sadly, that's true. They seem disinterested in him. I mean, it's because they don't know who he is. That's the sad thing. And if we could help people understand who he is, then they'd be more accepting of him. There are many who reject, but there are many who accept and receive him, believing in him and obeying him. And many of us here this morning, that's who we are. We've done that. But when it talks about believing, it means believing and going on believing. And when it talks about obeying, it means not just one obedience of the past, but we go on obeying him every day. That's our calling now. We obey him every day. And in Romans 1 verse 5, there's a nice little phrase. It talks about the obedience of faith. It's not just, oh, I believe in Jesus. It's the obedience of faith. Faith will obey. The real stuff obeys Jesus. That's why he says, if you love me, then you'll obey me. Not always the easiest thing to do. But so many rewards when we do so. Now, Jesus mixes some metaphors here because he talks about us being a building and he also talks about us being a priesthood. So he says, you also, like living stones, are being built into the spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So we are both bricks in a wall and also a priesthood. We are both bricks in a wall. We're part of a building, but we're also a priesthood. Now, just a few thoughts about these couple of things here. I told you this passage was packed. You're going to have to stay with me for a little while. I'm trying to sort of bring out the richness of it all. The church is not intended to be a massive pile of bricks, but we are bricks that have been put together into a building, and every brick is integrated and has its proper place. Every Christian has his part to play in that building. One of my favourite verses is at the end of Ephesians chapter 2. I've never really preached on it because I don't think I've got the ability to do it yet, but it's a great verse. And it's picking up this thing about us being a building and that the church corporately is the temple. And then it says, in this temple that the church is, God dwells by his Spirit. It's a wonderful concept, this. And this is what Peter's trying to capture here. You know, we're individually temples of the Holy Spirit, but corporately, in this building that has been put together, we are corporately the temple of God. But not just that, into that temple of God, God has come to dwell. So corporately, we are just something really special. And we sense that sometimes in our worship, because as we are worshiping together, as people who are part of that temple and filled with the Holy Spirit, we get a real sense of his presence amongst us. The presence that we are as a temple is then just enriched with the presence of God that comes upon that as well. So that's the first picture. We're not just a pile of bricks, but we've been put together, each playing our part in this building of God. But we're also a priesthood. And a priest is someone who has access to God. We don't need priests anymore, as they did in the Old Testament, because as Christians, we are all priests. And so we have immediate access to God. We can know him and love him just by the fresh air that we breathe. Sadly, some parts of the church still haven't quite got this right. I was part of a team working in a church in Bulgaria. And in Bulgaria, there's the Orthodox Church there. And I popped in one day just to see what was happening. It was during the week. And there were three priests at the front, and they were gabbling their way through the liturgy. And everybody was just walking about in the church. And the three priests were doing their priestly work at the front. Didn't need anybody else because the priests were doing their work at the front. Those in the church weren't really participating because the priests were doing the work on their behalf. Well, that's not really what it's about, because we're all the priesthood of all believers. Therefore, we are people that just have him near to us, and we have access to him. But this is the more important thing, and oh, that we'd understand this. Just like in the Old Testament, they needed the priest because he was the one that helped them to find access to God. If we're the priesthood today, who are we the priests on behalf of? Well, we are priests on behalf of those who have not found Jesus yet. And our calling is simply that. It's to help people find access to God. There's millions of them, actually, in this country and throughout the world that haven't found that yet. But you're a priest, and so therefore your job is to help them to find access to God through what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for them, dying on the cross. So we're both a building, and we are also a priesthood. So this is who we are, but I haven't quite finished yet because there are four other things that we are. And you know them well because Peter, he draws again on the Old Testament. It's so important, you know, to read the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. Because the more you'll understand the Old Testament, the more you'll understand the New Testament. And he's drawing here from Exodus 19:6, Isaiah 40, 43, and some parts of Hosea. And he's picking up four pictures of who we are. So let me finish with this. I mean, first of all, we are chosen people. Israel were chosen, but they failed. Jesus was the proper servant chosen by God, and he succeeded. And as we are in him, we are chosen people. This doesn't lead to pride, but it leads to just knowing just how merciful God has been to us, and it stimulates our praise. So say this after me. We are a chosen people. Let me hear it. We are a chosen people. Okay. But we're also, secondly, a royal priesthood. We've touched on this, but let me just say one other thing about it. Now, in the ancient world, a king had his own priest. And so the priests got very close to the king. We've been hearing a fair bit about the king lately. We've had a queen for a long time, but now, of course, we've got a king, and we've been hearing a lot about the king. Of course, it's important. But he's under patch on Jesus. He's the real king. In fact, he's the King of Kings. And as priests, we can live really near to the king. There's nobody like him. So say it after me. We are a royal priesthood. We are a royal priesthood. And then we're a holy nation. This doesn't mean just morally pure, but it's about people who belong to God in a way that other people who don't belong to God. We are God's special property, actually belonging to him and nobody else. It's a bit similar to the marriage covenant, where you forsake all others for the one that you've chosen to be your partner. This is why Israel, when they fell away from God, it was described as adultery, spiritual adultery, because they weren't keeping their part of the covenant. But naturally, it leads to living holy lives as well. So say this after me. We are a holy nation. We are a holy nation. And then finally, about a people belonging to God. We don't belong to the world, but we do need to know who we belong to. I began with a story about my own family and was I actually part of this family? I'm really interested in family tree. Been studying now for quite a few years. Actually, Nodding's quite an easy name. It's not like Smith, of course, is it? And when the certain points, you get really excited when you discover a particular thing. I remember when I was in Yorkshire and I discovered about Thomas Nodding, 1812, born in Catterick. Mm. And I actually got it right and I knew this was the one. Got so excited. I was with a cousin. And I'd got back to 1690 for quite a few years and I thought that might be it. But in the last year, I've gone back another four generations. I'm back to 1572, William Nodding, Coxwold, Yorkshire. You're thinking, okay, what's all this about? Well, all that's identity. But there is a greater identity. I get more excited about belonging to God. You know, if there's a fire in the house, you must have thought about this. What possessions would you try and get? Well, a lot of people would think, I need to get the photographs. If I can just get one thing before I escape from the fire, I'll go and get the photographs. But this is the great truth. If there's a fire in God's house, he goes and gets you. Because you belong to him. He knows what his most precious possessions are. So he goes and gets you because you belong to him. You don't belong to the world because you've decided now that you want to live your life in Jesus. And because you're living your life in Jesus, you now belong to him. It's great, isn't it? As a result of that, we will worship and we will witness. That's what the passage says. And let's close by saying these words together. After three, one, two, three. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Anybody cheerful about this? Now, I wonder whether there's people here this morning, and actually this is not true about you. It's not your fault. You haven't quite got it yet. You haven't got the fact of how important it is to be in Jesus. You see, outside of Jesus, you'll stumble, and it will lead to destruction. But if you're in Jesus, it's the most secure place in the world, and you have assurance that you belong to him. Now, it may be that all of us here have done that and we know that. I know a lot of you, that would be true, but maybe it's not true of all of you. Can I say grasp him this morning? Grasp him. He's done some great things for us. And ours is to believe in him and obey him. Okay, amen. Well, we've got a lovely song here. It's called No Longer Slaves, but it picks up the fact of being a child of God, to know that we are children of God. Let's sing this well.
When I was planning this and Peter asked for this song, I had this verse just come to me and it was just so related. It's from Romans 8:14-17, and it says, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." And as we sing this now, we can all know we are children of God and no longer slaves to anything because Jesus freed us. So, if you want to stand and sing if you're able. And we're going to sing together. Child.
Wow, what a declaration. If you have any doubt in your heart, don't go away without talking to somebody about it. There's opportunity this morning to just come to the front as we disperse, and our prayer team will be available to pray with you, talk with you. Or maybe you already know someone else in the church who would rather go to, but don't miss out. Don't miss out. Know your identity. Tea and coffee are going to be served, and if you can stay, have fellowship together, that would be great. So to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Have a super week, and we'll see you next week when we'll continue with our 1 Peter series. And thank you, Peter, for bringing the word this morning.